Right, the 10th round of negotiations in Khartoum between Egypt, Sudan, and Ethiopia on the Grand Renaissance Dam, the very controversial discussion of what exists in the Egyptian scene. Of course, it's controversial because many Egyptians are very much concerned with this issue. Let me first welcome our guest, Dr. Youssef Mazhar, African affairs expert. We thank you very much for being with us.
Thank you.
And we start from the 10th round of negotiations.
Yes.
And the 10th round of negotiations means that this is the 10th time that delegations from or the tripartite delegations sit together in order to find a solution.
Yes.
Or a breakthrough, or what we can call a win-win situation for all countries. This time they are speaking about the two firms and the reports that should be submitted by those two firms, particularly on the impact or the negative impact of the Renaissance Dam on Egypt and Sudan, the downstream countries.
Mm-hmm.
How do you view this round of talks? What should it be comprising more?
Yes, all right. Let me just add something to this very nice statement that you just made. You said the negative impact on Egypt and Sudan. I want to add something. There's a negative impact on Ethiopia itself. And this is something that people in building dams, and I've been looking at dams going back to the Hoover Dam, which was a very famous dam in the United States. Dams have a negative impact also on the people who build them. And I brought this up a number of times also with many of my Ethiopian friends, because it's not a question that I'm building a dam so other people are suffering and I'm not. In fact, if you're not careful with the way you plan a dam, if you get too, anxious and try to generate too much electricity, actually, one negative impact that is on the Ethiopian side is that to put a figure like 5,000 is a very large figure for a dam of power. That means you have to go and sell it to other countries, you've got to distribute it, you've got to take a transmission line, and sometimes you get very proud of your dam and sort of love it yourself, and then you find that it's nearly impossible to implement. The second thing, all this water, is you know, it rains in Ethiopia. I was in Ethiopia with the United Nations for a whole period, about 3 months, and it was raining day and night. So the water, this tremendous amount of water. Mm. So talking about that you need all this water is not really factual. So of course, when you're in a situation like this and you've got three main countries who are talking about it, then each one of the countries sort of takes a very possessive look at it. But well, some things are a fact. Egypt can suffer from such a dam. Not all the time. People are worried a little bit about the time it needed to fill up, you see, because there is a very general figure, which says that it will fill up in about one flood. I mean, there's a lot of talk about how long it will take. But during this filling up, that's the time that the water doesn't go through and the time that will cause a lot of damage. So some part of the negotiations is on the rate of filling up. Now, the two companies, you mentioned them. At the beginning, there was one Dutch and one French. Mm. Now the two are French. And I looked very carefully at the qualifications of those two, because you think, well, what kind of a consultant is there to talk about a dam and its impact on people? And I noticed that one of the French companies was very conversant with people, culture, habitats, life. So it was not pure technical. It was not pure megawatts and cubic meters. And that made me feel more comfortable. The other consultant is very much a management consultant. How long it will it take? It's big contracting, progressing all the contracting that is needed. So I think these two companies will come out, they're consultants, by the way, they will come out with something which is fair, I think. But what bothers me, actually, the figure is 8 months.
The report will take 8 months.
Yes, I might be wrong, but this is what I read in some of the...
So let me here take from what you said, sir, and you said that one of the firms are very much concerned with the habitat and the, the cultural environment and all this. And you said that this made you relieved to a certain extent. So why is that so?
Look, people should appreciate that when Egypt speaks, it speaks out of experience. We built a dam, and we had people who let's say the dam affected their lives, the people of Nuba. So we know what it means. We know what it means to move people. And in this Ethiopian dam, there's the Umu Valley. And there are very rare tribes there, very old tribes that go very far back even in Christianity. And the figure of displacement in the preliminary figure they're talking about is 20,000 people, which is a lot. So that's why I say countries should be aware of thinking about grandiose things, and it might even hurt them. It's not hurting somebody else. You're hurting yourself. And one of the things is that when these consultants will be working, I'm sure they're going to come out with how are you going to move these people. Remember in Egypt, we said Nubia, and then we said we gave them houses. They didn't quite like these houses. They were used to living in the wild or in the outdoor, and we gave them concrete houses. So they've got to learn, and I've got many Ethiopian friends, by the way, and when this started, we started corresponding. Some of them are just so euphoric about the whole thing, they have no time to think. But the others who think have been thinking about what will happen to all these people. Do we need all this electricity? Should we, you know, they have these turbines, they're called Francis turbines, water turbines. And there's a number on this side of them, on the other side. The amount is not needed. Why do you want to put all this investment, all this money into turbines that will, their power will be needed maybe 5 or 10 years down the line. So there's an overcapacity of the whole thing, and I hope these consultants will come out with these, let's say, what we think is the more obvious things.
Right, I guess we have over the phone Dr. Diyadin Al-Kursi, who is an water or international water expert. Good evening to you, sir.
Good evening to you.
And again, we are speaking about the Renaissance Dam. This is the 10th round of negotiations. Now, the Grand Renaissance Dam has been already on the ground, and we know that part of it was has already been built. So how do you view the significance of this 10th round of negotiations? What should be coming out from the Egyptian and Sudanese parties regarding the dam? How do you view the report of those two firms we are expecting?
Well, I believe we are in a new sort of stage now. The first stage was between the three delegates, three delegations, Ethiopian, Egyptian, and Sudanese, and two consulting friends, one from France and one from Holland. Now there was no agreement, or apparently there was no agreement between the two consulting offices, although I feel that, that there were some pressure on the two consulting offices not to agree, because simply Ethiopia doesn't like to have this job completed. They don't like to see a report which shows that some significant harm will be put on the Egyptian quota, and significant harm on the decrease of the generation of hydropower from the High Aswan Dam, and significant harm on the deterioration of the environmental conditions of the northern part of the Nile Delta. Ethiopia doesn't like to see this at all in public. My own feeling, I'm not pessimistic, I'm not optimistic, I'm realistic now. And I feel that during the coming stage, Ethiopia will find ways and means of hindering and putting obstacles in front of these two consulting offices who are both now from France. And one of them was in direct contact with the Ethiopian government for 15 continuous years before. So they know him very well and he knows them very well. But in spite of all this, I'm sure that things will never go smooth because Ethiopia, as I said, they don't like to have this report produced. And whatever the consulting office is, he will certainly admit that there is going to be a significant harm on the Egyptians if the Renaissance Dam is built according to the dimensions given by the Ethiopians now. Right. So I'm 100% sure that we will not finish this job as required, because in August 2014, they said in 2 weeks' time we'll have a consulting office, and in six months' time we'll have a report produced. And they are saying now that we have to sort of assign the consulting office as soon as we can, and before the end of this year we'll have the reports in our hands. And I'm very much doubtful about this type of status.
Right. Dr. Diyar Kousi, if we are speaking here about what could be, technically I'm speaking here, what could be acceptable for Egypt if the Ethiopians are adamant to continue on with the dam? What could be technically acceptable for Egypt and does not really affect Egypt's share from the Nile?
The conditions which might be acceptable to the Egyptian party is to go back to a small dam, 80, 90 meters high, without this big saddle dam, and the reduction of the reservoir from the present 74 billion cubic meters to the original size of 9 to 14 billion cubic meters. This was the dimensions of the border dam, and these were the dimensions of the Millennium Dam as declared in by the beginning of the millennium. So with the existing dimensions, Egypt will never accept that, and with the existing dimensions, there will be a significant harm on the Egyptians.
I guess we'll have to wait and see the upcoming steps. Dr. Diyar Diyar Kousi, water or international water expert, thank you very much for being with us over the phone. Back to you, Dr. Mazhar, and how do you view the next steps? What would Egypt be taking in the upcoming stage?
Well, let me first say what my colleague Dr. Kousi is saying, who's really a mastermind and expert in this area, has been for many, many years, is all very true. I can only add that with international, negotiations, and there's no real power of one party to stop another party, there are other things. We know the situation, but I think one should try and make the best of it. Some people, and I'm one of them, feel that just saying we don't agree is not enough. I think the biggest card that exists is to really convince the Ethiopian side that they have really got too big a project on their hands. As you can see from the figures given by Dr. Hussein, even the height of the dam is considerably higher than the original. The amount of water is magnified, and the electricity, as I mentioned before, is absolutely not necessary. So I think what we have in our hands is, if this message can be, let's say, substantiated by the consultants also, that this is much too big, not necessary, not really economic, not, and will cause a lot of trouble to the builder himself, then maybe they can talk about a first phase and a second phase. That would be that the first phase, and then they can see what will happen, and then a second phase. But to go all the way, and I actually don't understand, you know, the high demon we did it, Egypt went through a lot of suffering to finance it, even though we had the Soviet Union at that time really helping hand, and not at cost price, at very much less than that. And now, a relatively small country like Ethiopia, with limited resources like all of us, has to go on such a thing. And the Italian firm, the contractor who's doing this, I don't see that any of the international fundings are really there. The World Bank at one time was very interested, now it's not really there. So it is it's really a very big gamble and a very tremendous burden on the builders of this dam. So they should look at this like this, not a question we want less and they want more. They should think, do they really need all this? Do they really need to do all this and do it now? I think that's the only way we can get to get a solution.
But all this have been spoken about before. I mean here that water experts have been saying that all the time, and the Ethiopian side are not convinced with the Egyptian water experts and what they are saying. President Sisi himself went several times and met with Mariam Dizelinia, and he presented and reiterated the Egyptians, all the Egyptian concerns, and he said that Egypt is, and we are really keen on continuing with a brotherly relations, not just brotherly, because we share the same future, we share the same destination. Mm-hmm. We are not interested in their own richness. In fact, we are, or we want both richness, or both the aspiration of both the Ethiopians and the Egyptian aspiration together. But they were not convinced. So what really can convince Ethiopians that, or of the whole idea, sir, you've been speaking about, that this is not necessary, all this, this huge, tremendous dam is not necessary? What could really convince them
I think it's a difficult question, of course. If one party can't really convince the other, if they have got different views. But the third party, who are the third party? Don't forget, there are lots of people, there are lots of organizations around the world. There's organizations who take care of dams, organizations who study dams, organizations who have documented all the dams. And there's experiences. I was looking the other day at something which exists, which are the 10 biggest dams in the world at the moment. And it's there, clear, the side effects, the silting. We haven't talked about the silting. Even the high dam, there's a problem with silting, but a minor problem. With all this water coming in, carrying all this silt, it settles. Mm. And if you go back in Egyptian history, the first dam, which was the Aswan Dam, or barrage, it was had to be elevated a number of times because the silting kept on reducing the effect of the dam itself. And I think if we get away from the first excitement and the insistence on a certain point, if all these facts are put not only by the Egyptians, but by the consultants to a certain extent, and put by the international community, I'm sure people in their right mind will see that this is a dangerous game. Mm. You're we're not talking, people talk about the white elephant. Well, maybe it's an elephant here, maybe it's not the white elephant, but it's a load on the builder, a terrible load. And the side effects, we with our high dam, with very controlled environment, with all the possibilities of Egypt, with all the know-how, we had our little problems. It be magnified there.
Very much indeed. From the Egyptian side, what kind of alternatives can we really offer in order to resolve such any kind of disagreement or any kind of negative impacts and get to a win-win situation?
Look, there were things that could have been done at the beginning. If you look at now the energy coming out of this dam, and you must see where is this energy going. You'll find there have now at 7 partners for Ethiopia to get their electricity. That means you have lost 7, let's say, voters, because they are involved. This electricity has been contracted for and paid for to some extent with these neighboring countries. So we must be careful that you must, in any business, have some advantage for people. Mm. And the Ethiopians have given the advantage of the electric power to some of the neighboring countries, so they might be very sympathetic to this idea. We always thought, some of the people who think around here, let's try and be more partners. Let's try and put our contractors to work with them. Let us, apart from, of course, the stand, the political stand, but also to be a partner, to get involved, to try and help out. If you become a partner in this project, you have more to say than being just on the other side of the fence. I think, or at least I hope, and some people are thinking of that this grotesque and very large project, people will realize, the builders, people downstream realize already, and the international community will realize that it's not that benefit. There's no reason to be so stiff about it. And people should let go now. And everybody hopes that these consultants, when they bring out all the side effects or all the impacts, they will bring out lots of things. We know more or less more of them. But when they quantify them, when they say there are 30,000 people who are going to be out of their homes, when they say there's going to be so many thousand acres of swamps, I think this will wake people up. That is not a question of just insisting I must have the biggest dam in Africa, but the biggest dam is not the best dam in this case.
Yes. That's what we are hoping for. We are hoping for the Ethiopians to come to reason and start negotiating on a real win-win situation. It's not just negative impact that will be really on us, on the Egyptians, but rather on two countries and even the hosting or the one who is really constructing this dam. Unfortunately, we will have to wait and see how the 10th round of negotiations will turn to be or what will come out of it. Dr. Youssef Mazhar, African Affairs Secretary, thank you very much for joining
us. Thank you.
Moving on to our next segment, the second one, and Egyptian pound continued to weaken on the black market on Sunday, piling more pressure on the central bank to devalue the currency even as the official rate against the dollar remained unchanged at an auction. This came after the bank began holding meetings with foreign exchange bureaus last week to try to keep a lid on the black market rates for the dollar. We'll watch this report and how the central bank is really managing this situation, and we'll come back for discussion.
The central bank has begun holding meetings with foreign exchange bureaus to try to keep a lid on black market trades for the dollar. There will be other meetings every week. Egypt, which relies heavily on imports, has been facing the shortage of foreign currency since the 2011 revolution drove away tourists and investors to a major source of hard currency. But the central bank has resisted devaluating the pound, keeping it artificially strong at 7.7301 to dollar. The black market rates has weakened, however, hovering around 8.7 pounds in the last week. Officially, the central bank allows exchange bureaus to sell dollars at up 15 piastres either side of its set price. But the bureaus have been known to demand more for the greenback when it is in short supply. The country's foreign reserves have tumbled to around $16.5 billion from about $36 billion before the 2011 revolution. That has put pressure on the exchange rate, which has weakened steadily from about 5.8 pounds per dollar 5 years ago. Former central bank governor Hesham Rames had fought the black market head-on, talking publicly about crushing it and shutting down dozens of exchange bureaus selling at unofficial rates. Bankers and traders said that the Tarek Amir, who took over from Rames in November, is taking a different approach, trying to work with exchange bureaus to control the market. Nevertheless, on Sunday, the Egyptian pound continued to weaken on the black market, piling more pressure on the central bank to devalue the currency, even as the official rate against the dollar remained unchanged on auction. At Sunday's auction, the bank sold $39.1 million at a cutoff price of 7.7301 Egyptian pound to the dollar, unchanged from the previous auction on Thursday.
Right, welcome back and to our other important and controversial segment that we're speaking about. Let me welcome our guest, Mr. Hussein Shafie, economic expert. Thank you very much for being with us.
Thank you.
And you have been seeing, of course, how the selling of the dollar is going on in the black market, the efforts that have been made by the central bank in order to see how it is dealing with the situation. We want exactly to understand what is the problem here.
I think the problem is very clear, and finally they start talking about it, the officials, the expert. Simply, Egypt import for over $70 billion. Egypt export only for $25 billion. Mm. The gap between it's the tremendous. Two figures is 55
it's
million.
Tremendous.
Okay, no. Somebody has to pay for this gap. So we get all the money coming from the Egyptians living abroad, which is around $19 billion. We get the Suez Canal income. We used to get the tourist income revenue. We used to get the petroleum in the good days. Mm. So even the gap, by the way, the gap was never that big. Mm. Okay. But when it was, there are a gap anyhow, and it is in the favor of the importations, not the exportations. We used to cover it. We used to have the resources to cover it. But now we don't. We have a shortage of over $20 to $25 billion every year. We don't know where to get it from. We go and borrow it from the Gulf countries, from the international banks. Somebody has to pay for this. We're talking about hard currencies now. We're talking about this amount of money needed. So, you need this $70 billion. Mm. You need to pay for the goods you imported for. And we're not even talking here about the Egyptians who are taking money with them for medical treatment or for tourism. We're not talking, or even for investment abroad. We're not talking about that. We're only covering one sector, which is the gap between import and export. So as long as this gap is not covered and there are no resources for it, like Saudi Arabia has the oil to have that. But if we don't have the resources, we will have always a problems to get these hard currencies, and it will be always a monopoly for whatever available, and the prices will keep going up.
Hmm. the prices will keep going up, and the black market, the dollar reached a very huge difference between between the price of the dollar in, or the legal one and the black market one. And how do you view this issue? How is this emerging as a problem?
Well, we are not the only country in the world facing this problem. Of course, there are quite a few countries facing this. And some of them, simply, they float their currencies. Mm. And once they float their currencies, like Brazil, every single day the prices are different. Mm. I used to be in Rio de Janeiro, and I used to see in the second day, if you go for shopping, you see the same thing, and they even put the formula. So you don't really, you calculate it yourself. So if you want to buy a shirt or a shoes, whatever, you pay today different from tomorrow because of the currencies. As long as the income adjusted the same way, the country can survive. And that's happened in Brazil, by the way. So every month, all the employees, private sectors and the public sectors, they readjust their salaries.
Oh.
Yes, based on this. Okay, they have a formula to calculate the expenses because, well, you take a salary not just to have, to look for it. You have to spend it for food and for other items for life. If these items keep increasing, then your salary has to be increased as well. But there are equations for that.
Hmm. What kind of equation for that?
When the price of the dollar, because you don't depend 100% on importations, you have local items as well. Therefore, the cost of goods, this is a government or government organization issue monthly report about the increase of the cost of goods of consumers. And based on this changes and increase, this is the one it should be adjusted in the salary. So you don't adjust it automatically, the difference, it's very complicated. We hope we don't get to that. But I'm saying this is what happened in places like Brazil and other Latin America. That's the way they do it. So the inhabitants, the people live in the country, do not suffer a lot because the prices go up. What is the problem if the dollar goes up here in Egypt? The only problem that the prices will go up because we're importing a lot of goods. So whatever being imported, the prices will go up. So if the prices go up and my salary did not increase, how I can afford it? I will not. Then I will start to complain. I will start to be unhappy. And that's why we have a problem. We have to resolve this problem.
So if we remember, a few days ago there was a presidential decision to raise the customs on some of the imported goods, and so it has relevance to the problem we're speaking about here.
Absolutely,
yes.
It is to the bottom of the problem. Because the main goal for this, the main targets for this issue is to decrease the importations. How are you going to decrease it? There are a lot of methods to do it. Mm. Sometimes by increasing, because we left really everyone, there are no regulations in Egypt about importation. So everyone imported everything. So we're importing nuts, we're importing chocolates, we're importing foods for dogs and cats. We're importing a lot of products who are produced in Egypt. Do you believe that we import sugar to the point that our factory, our local factory in Egypt, cannot sell their products? This is really crazy. Nobody do that.
It's tragic.
It is a tragic. Mm. Somebody has to really have be very serious and have the guts to make the right decisions. You know, of course I can look for the formula why our sugar will be more expensive than the imported one in the markets. Is it the quality or it is the price? I can work in that. But end of the line, I have to protect and help my own product for a while, not forever. Simply because by protecting our products, I'm saving the hard currencies for importations, so the dollar will not go up because there are no demand on it. Secondly, I really put an incentives to this industry, and this industry will grow and hire more people. That means less unemployment. That means people would earn money, go and spend it in the economy, and turn the whole game to a real successful business cycle.
If we are speaking here about the gap between the exports and the imports, and we are speaking that we want to manage imports and or how those who or importers deal. How are we dealing with this? I mean, is there is a kind of authority or system that is really controlling what is being imported imported from outside, from abroad? Is there an authority or a system that is really controlling exporters so we can have the maximum benefit out of what we are exporting? I mean, to where are we exporting, with which price, what we're getting from, I mean, all these, do we have systems for to control those two parts?
Of course, I don't want to go back to Nasser time when it was practically the only one can import is the government.
No, definitely
okay.
Not.
We don't want to go there.
A system that knows who are the importers, who are the exporters, what do they export and what do they import.
But by the same saying, I don't want to go to the point that in Sadat afterwards, after that, that the whole door is open and anyone can import anything. And I mean, we are not United States or even Saudi Arabia. We don't have a lot of capital here. We are not a very rich country to keep importing all these luxurious, even if there are a few rich personnel in the country can afford that, but that's not the society. That's only a small group. And even for a social reason, we should not really allow this kind of goods to be easily comes. If they want to import it, I think I should put a very high tariff on it, so the government will take an advantage and take this tariff to help the people or make projects with it. So the only in any place in the world, the one who really control this is a combination between the government, the authority, and the private sector.
Exactly. This
they
exactly.
sit together and they arrange it together. Of course, if I am an importer for nuts or for chocolates and I've been making a lot of profits for all these years and all of a sudden the regulations changed on me, I will complain. And I will make a very high voice against it because you are touching my income. You are touching my business. Okay? But if I look to the picture on the whole country, not on my personal situations, that's different. That's why I'm saying we have to sit together, the authority and the private sectors, and come to the benefits of this country. And sometimes the decisions is difficult on some individuals, but the government can help them in moving to a different direction in another product. I mean, the importer of chocolates, yeah, he has a lot of experience and had a lot of clients and an easy make, but he can go and switch to another product. He is not going to stop. Okay, maybe the government can give him some hand, less taxes, some incentives to help him for a few years until go and do another business.
Getting back to what we were discussing at the very beginning and the black market and the dollar in the black market, and the central government have been trying to make as much as possible efforts in order to keep a lid on the black market rates. How do you view the efforts that have been exerted, the decisions that have been taken by the central bank so far in being able even to put this lid?
I think they're doing a very great job to do that, but I'm afraid in the end, if they don't solve the real problem, it's not going to work. It's going to work for 1 year, for 1.5 years, for 2 years, but if you go for the curve, you see, go for the dollar price against the Egyptian pounds in the last 10 years and see the curve. It never declined, it keep going up, okay? Simply because we never solve the real problem. I tell you what they do. They calculate the demands on the importations. Let's say I need this month 5 billion US dollar. So they get from different directions 2.5. So they short of 2.5. They go and borrow 2 billion from international banks or from some Gulf countries and make it available to the banks here. So the importer can find it in the official rate. So there are no need for the black markets. What you're doing here, you are subsidizing the importer. Okay? Because and in a way, you're subsidizing the end users as well. Because you're really paying him the dollar with an official rate, but when you want to pay it back, it will cost you much more than you already sold it. You got the point? Okay, the government borrow 1 billion, but when they pay this 1 billion back, it will cost them much more than the price they pay in it, they sell it to the banks, to the local banks, which is official rate. So in a way, what I'm saying is the government, by doing this, they're solving the problem temporary. But in the long term, it's more pressures and more burden on them to pay back this loan.
Now, part of what the central bank has been doing here is that during a last week meeting between the central bank governor and some of the big exchanges, they have agreed to bring the prices of the dollar in the black market down to 8.6 pounds. That was last week, because it is different this week. However, the bankers and the exchange traders said that the plan is unlikely to succeed because of the black market is guided by the supply and the demand. And here, as you said, sir, that sometimes if they are not able to collect what they need from the bank, they have to go
to the black market. Exactly. They don't have an alternative. Exactly. Then the offices sell them these prices. They make a monopoly. How you can to control that?
Exactly. How can we control that?
You can close all the offices you want. They make the exchange now outside Egypt. Do you know that? A lot of importers get their hard currencies from abroad.
I didn't know that.
Oh yeah, that's lately what happened.
So the Egyptian pound is changed outside Egypt.
Exactly.
And it is accepted.
It is accepted.
That's quite
it's a big game, much bigger than all of us, and there are too many players for it, and the only way I see it, it's to close this game, you have to either deliver the number of hard currencies equivalent to the demand, the official demands for the importations or whatever, or keep cutting, keep decreasing the importations, keep increasing the exportations, keep increasing all your resources for hard currencies. You have to play the game this way. And you said, how are we going to resolve it? I think the government should really make a very, very serious decisions. Say, I have to cut the importations 10% every year for the next 10 years. I have to increase the exportation by 5% every year. The gap will be getting closer. Then the pressures will be off.
Yes. Here we are speaking about the possibility of reactivating the interbank mechanism to exchange Arab currencies instead of the pound for dollars. How effective is this?
It will help until you start depending on this Arab hard currencies, and all of a sudden you don't have enough. It will have this. It doesn't matter. When you talk about the hard currency, it's not really the dollar. It is a dollar today because that's what all our exchanges based on the dollar, but if you change it to Arab ruble, the only way, like for example, when the negotiation between Egypt and Russia before this unfortunate accident happened, they sending 4 million tourists here, and instead of they pay Egypt in dollar, and we pay them for whatever we imported. You know,
and, we said we can change the currency from
we exchange either by Egyptian pounds or by rubles.
Yeah.
But if we do that, but this is again in the end of the line based on exchanging import and export to balance the practically no gaps. You know, whatever you do, the picture has to be this way. The gap has to be very small. You can afford paying for this from your resources, from the transfer for, and the other resources.
I guess that will have to be the challenge in this upcoming period, how to minimize the gap between exports and imports. We'll have to wait and see. Mr. Hussein Shafie, Economic Expert, thank you very much for joining us.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Dear viewers, many thanks for watching. Tomorrow will be another contentious debate with another colleague. Good night.